Okay, so let's start. So last time we proved this monotone sequential continuity result, which says that if you have a monotone sequence, then the measure of the limit is the limit of the measures of that sequence. But here AN is a monotone sequence. Okay, we did this, and as a corollary of this, we proved this sigma sub additivity, meaning that if you have a countable family of events, then the probability of the union is less than the probabilities of the individual sets forming the union. Ha şey anladım. O bir dakika. Şimdi tamam mı? Tamam. Yanlış kameraya vermişim. Okay. Alright, so we proved this. So today I will start with an exercise, actually. But then I okay, gave a solution also. Anyway, let me just state it. So let AI and BI be two countable families of events such that for all I in the index set, we have BI is contained in EI. Okay, then the statement is this: the probability of the union of AIs minus the probability of the union of BIs is less than the difference of the probabilities of AI and BIs summed up over the index set. Okay. Yeah, I gave this as an exercise, but then I somehow okay, so let me give this to you as an exercise. I have the solution. I'll put the solution to my notes, but first I want you to work on this. Okay. If you cannot do it, just ask me. As a corollary of what we have done, we have so-called sequential continuity. What does this tells us is the following. So let AN be an arbitrary countable family, of course, sequence of events. Then probability of lim inf AN is less than lim inf of probability of AN, and this is less than lim sup of probability of AN, And this is less than P of lim sup of an. So here the first and the last one are lim sups of sequence of events. And then you take the probability of those you know, events. But the one in the middle, the ones in the middle are lim inf and lim sup of sequence of real numbers, okay? So there are two different kinds of lim sup and lim inf. One of them is for sets, or the other one is for numbers, sequence of numbers. Proof, basically, you know, you write down the definitions and what we have proved so far. So let me start with the expression on the left. Lim p of lim inf a n, okay. Well, what is this? Lim inf is this, right? It is the union of the intersections of a n's, right? For each m, I consider the intersection of the tail of the sequence starting from m, okay? And then I take unions of these, right? That's the lim inf of a n. We look at the tail of the sequence, we take the intersections of all of them, and then we take the unions of those intersections. All right, this is what? This is lim over m a n. Why is that? Because this sequence here is a monotone sequence, right? This is an increasing sequence. You are taking intersections of each time one less set. Therefore, you have a monotone sequence. And for monotone sequences, we know that we can write the probability. Okay, no, it is not this. These two are the same. This is just the definition of limit of a monotone sequence. And then I take limit outside, right? This is the monotone. So this is by the monotone sequential continuity, which we proved last time. So let me tell you. Okay, this proposition. If you have a monotone sequence, then probability of the limit is just limit of the probabilities. Okay. So this step is from there. And then we have what? Okay. This thing here is just P of infimums of this. Yeah, and this thing is less than lim inf of p of am, where the last inequality follows. Since infimum of ans is less than is contained in am, okay, so this subset infimum of the sequence is contained in AM because what is the infimum? You take the tail intersections of those and then you take union. But when you take the intersections, you start with AM already, AM and then so on. Therefore, okay. Since this is contained in AM, the probability of this is less than probability of this. Okay. Şöyle yazmışım aslında. So that P of infimum of n larger than m a n is less than p of a m for all m and thus lim p of infimum a n n larger than m, this is equal to okay. Here at this point we use the fact that the sequence is monotone, okay? The sequence is monotone. Well, similarly, one can prove this. What we have done for infimum can be repeated for supremum also. Lim sup of a n. You just follow similar steps and you end up with this lim sup p of a m. And then since this lim sup is larger than lim inf, lim inf, we obtain the following. Finally, since lim inf p a n, this is a sequence of real numbers. This is lim sup, lim inf is less than lim sup of p of a m, we obtain the result, okay? Right. This is greater than this one, this is greater than this one, and this is greater than this one. Okay. Okay, we have another result. Let AN again be a sequence in the sigma algebra such that the sum of the probabilities is finite, okay, not infinite, then P of AN this is zero. What was this? This was meaning that the probability of AN's events infinitely many times occurring. So the probability of infinitely many ANs occur is zero. Okay, so this is the meaning. In the proof, I will come back to this notation again. Now, by first of all, sigma additivity, we have this zero probability of ANs n greater than m. So you take the tail and probability of the tail. This is less than by the sigma additivity, sum of the probabilities. But by assumption, this summation is finite. So these are non-negative real numbers, infinitely many of them added up, countably many real numbers added up, finite. This means what? This means the tail goes to zero, right? This sequence should go to zero. Okay, since let me write it this way, n from 1 to infinity p a n is finite, limit this limit should go to zero. Not just individual ANs, probability of ANs, but the tail should go to zero, right? The tail should go to zero. Because you take first n terms, that is close to the total sum, then you increase this. So finite sums are converging to the limit. Therefore, the tail has to go to zero, okay? The individual elements, this goes to zero, but actually it is more than that. The whole tail should go to zero because if you have a convergent series, the sum of partial sums should converge to the limit. Therefore, there is no room for the tail. The tail should go to zero. Okay, well, thus we have this. Zero equals limit as m goes to infinity, n larger than m, p a n. I just write this. Okay, this is zero. But this is greater than limit as m goes to infinity, p of this by the subadditivity by this. Okay. And this is equal to p of limit as m goes to infinity of unions of ans. Sorry, şöyle yazayım. An larger than m. Okay. Yes. This is monoton sequential continuity. Monoton sequential continuity. And this is, of course, just P of the intersection over M of the unions of the elements in the tail. Okay. This is a monoton sequence of sets. Its limit is just either intersection or union, depending on whether the sequence is decreasing or increasing. Here, this sequence is decreasing because each time you take union of one less family. So we have this. So the probability of this is zero. Okay. Because this is something non-negative, but it is less than zero, so it is zero. Hence, P of a n infinitely often. So this means what? The probability of infinitely many ANs occur. Okay? This is by definition, this is just lim sup of AN. Okay? Lim sup of AN. And we just okay. Lim sup means just this expression. So it is P of M n larger than M AN, and that is zero. Okay, so if you just think about, what does this tells us? So if we have infinitely many events, a sequence of events, and if the sum of the probabilities is finite, then the probability that some ANs infinitely many times, no, infinitely many ANs the probability of infinitely many ANs occur is zero, right? Yani şunun anlamı nedir? Bunun sonsuz kere, değil mi? Sonsuz tane bir dakika. Nasıl bunu söylemiştik? Şeyi unuttum. Kim? O lim supu yaptığımız zaman fazla mı gittim? Şurada evet, yani lim sup'un pozitif olması infinitely many AN'in occur etmesi demek. Burada da lim sup sıfır olduğuna göre infinitely many AN'in occur etme olasılığı sıfır. Okay. Okay. Probability space'i biz tarif etmedik mi? Ettik sanki ama buraya tekrar neyse yazayım. Let sigma and a be a measurable space. Space and let P be a probability measure on the sigma algebra, then the triple sigma omega A and P is called a probability measure. Sorry, space. Probability space. Measure'ı tarif etmiştik de bunu tarif etmeliydik sanırım. Okay. Another definition. Let again, this time this is a probability space. Let be omega AP be a probability space. A subset A of no, a subset N of omega is set to be negligible. That's why we denote it by N. If there is a measurable space, a measurable set A, so that N is contained in A, and the measure of A is empty. Okay. The subset N itself may not be measurable, so you may not measure its size. However, if it is contained in something measurable and that thing has measure zero, then we say that N is negligible. Although we cannot measure its size, we call it negligible because it is contained in something we can measure, but that thing has measure zero. All right. Okay. If the sigma algebra A contains all the negligible sets, then this sigma algebra is said to be complete. Okay. So if your sigma algebra contains all of its negligible sets as a measurable set, then we call that sigma algebra complete. Okay. Of course, when you consider finite probability spaces, these are not, irrelevant because everything is finite. You can list all of them. However, if your omega is, let's say, real numbers, then the sigma algebra is possibly something very big, okay? Even if you take Borel sets, it's a huge family. And sometimes and there are sets, still there are sets which cannot be expressed by the elements of your Borel algebra. In other words, they cannot be expressed as the unions and intersections of open sets or their complements. Okay, there are a lot of such sets, and you cannot measure them. If they are not Borel, you cannot measure them, and in that case, of course, that's a problem. However, those sets which are contained in, let's say, measurable sets with measure zero, then we can kind of ignore them, call them negligible. Or you may just join them into your sigma algebra and defining your measure on them as zero, because they are already contained in some measurable sets with measure zero. So you may just define their measure to be zero. Okay? Even though they are not measurable start with. You can extend your measure and call them, you know, having measure zero. We will come to that point again. I have one more definition. So let be a omega AP be a probability space. Then a property. Property which holds for all omega elements of omega, for all omega except on a negligible subset of omega okay is set to hold almost everywhere. We abbreviate this by writing AE or PAE or almost all omega or almost surely AS or PAS. So there are many notations we use for this. So if you have a property which holds for many or most of the elements of the algebra, meaning that the set of omegas where this property doesn't hold has measure zero or it is negligible, we call it that property almost all for example maybe for example consider such a graph. Such a function like this, okay. This function is continuous except, let's say, 2 points. The measure of 2 points, Borel measure of 2 points, is zero. So this function is, continuous. Or the set of points where this function is not continuous is measure zero. So let's say this is point minus one and one. So this function is continuous on R minus minus one plus one. So the set of points where this is not continuous is this one, and it has measure zero because you can put these two numbers in an interval, right? The measure, Lebesgue measure, şöyle diyeyim, if A is, then Lebesgue measure of A is zero. just 2 points. Why is that? Because I can put finitely many points into intervals of any size, right? I can choose this intervals as small as I want. Okay, therefore the measure of this will be less than the measure of this intervals, which is 2 epsilon, or well, maybe 4 epsilon, but epsilon can be chosen arbitrarily small. Therefore, the measure of this set is 0. So we may say that this function is, for example, continuous almost everywhere. Okay, it is not continuous at some points, but the points at which this is not continuous is negligible. Okay, so f is continuous almost everywhere. Here is a result which tells us that you can make your sigma algebra a bit larger to contain all the negligible sets. Okay, so let me do this. If n denotes the class of all negligible sets of a probability space, then a closure, what is this? You take A union n's. A is from your algebra, n is from the set of negligible sets, or class of negligible sets, coincides with the sigma algebra. Algebra generated by A and this, and moreover, the formula, which formula? P bar. So I extend my measure to this, bigger algebra defines the unique probability P bar on A bar, which extends P. Okay. So this is actually is formalizing what I have said a couple minutes ago. If your algebra is not complete, for example, if there are sets, negligible sets, which doesn't belong to your algebra, then you can form a bigger algebra. And that algebra is just the sigma algebra generated by your original algebra and the class of negligible sets. And this proposition tells us that actually sigma algebra, elements of that sigma algebra are actually, can be expressed as follows. They are nothing but such unions. One set from your sigma algebra and one element from your negligible class. You take just those elements, they form the sigma algebra generated by A and N. Okay. Moreover, now your algebra is complete because it contains all of its negligible elements or negligible sets. Moreover, you can extend your measure to this bigger sigma algebra. How? You just define the measure of A union N as the measure of A. This is, you know, this makes sense because N is negligible. N is contained in something measurable, which is measure zero. So you may define it this way. And it turns out that, you know, this really defines a measure on this bigger class or bigger, you know, sigma algebra. What is the, you know, I mean, meaning of this? Even if the algebra you start with is not complete, you know, you can just add negligible sets and it becomes complete, and being complete will turn out to be something important later. Okay, so it's like rational numbers and real numbers. Okay, you may work with rational numbers. Actually, this is what we do in, you know, real life. We never actually come up with irrational numbers and so on. We always use rational numbers, but we need usually, you know, to, if you want to prove things, you need a complete number system. Then you have to put back, you know, irrational numbers to the, you know, your system, and you obtain a complete number system. That's important, not maybe for practical purposes, but for theoretical purposes, that is something very important. This is something like this, okay? Most of the time, you don't actually see those negligible sets. They are kind of weird objects, okay? You cannot measure them. For example, if you think about Lebesgue measure, any countable set is measurable because, you know, each point is measurable and has measure zero. Therefore, any countable set has measure zero, because, you know, if you have a countable set, then the total measure is just the measures of the elements. So let me just, maybe as an example, consider the measure mu on R. Measure of, you know, a singleton is zero because since this set is contained in minus epsilon epsilon for any epsilon positive, so that measure of this, which is something non-negative, is less than the measure of this, which is 2 epsilon. So measure of this is less than 2 epsilon, but epsilon is any arbitrary positive number. Therefore, measure of a singleton is zero. But then if A is a sequence, okay, a countable set, then what is the measure of this? This is the disjoint union of singletons, right? Disjoint union of singletons. Then A is just actually this. And thus, by the you know, monotone, neydi bu, sub, by the sigma sub additivity, the measure of this, measure of this is less than the measures of each an, but measure of each of this is zero, therefore this is zero. This means that measure of any countable set is zero. Çok emin değilim ya. Onu düşünmek lazım. Emin değilim ondan. What I want to say is here, for example, if you take A equals Q, a countable set, then measure of Q is also zero. So, arkadaşınız şey sordu, hani bu şuna mı benziyor dedi. Bir dart fırlattığınızda hani bir yere saplanıyor. O aslında bir nokta değil, hani küçük de olsa bir alana karşılık geliyor. Ama hani onu biz de sıfır gibi görüyoruz gibi, hani ona benzer bir şey mi dedi, ama ben çok emin olamadım hani o. Anlamadım işin açıkçası tam o şeyi, bağlantısını. Biraz kafa yormak lazım belki. So here, for example, Lebesgue measure of rational numbers is zero. Q is a measurable set and it has measure zero. But there are many other sets which has measure zero and they are uncountable, okay, and they are not easy to describe, okay. One of them is so-called Cantor set, okay. It's an uncountable set. Actually, it is even measurable, and it is measure zero. But there are sets, which are not measurable, and they have they are contained in a measurable set which has measure zero. Therefore, even in this example of Lebesgue measure on the real number system, there are many pathologies, okay? And actually, I mean, to avoid those possible pathological problems, it is good to have your measure space to be complete. And this proposition tells us that you can always actually assume that your measure space is complete by just adding negligible sets. Even though you don't know what they are, you just add them up and you obtain a complete set, a complete measure space or probability space. Okay, for the proof of this, I'll probably talk about it later. So maybe it's a good point to stop. No.